Hello and welcome to Business on the Wire. Struggling to meet her government's disinvestment target, in a surprise move, the finance minister announced that LIC would be listed on the stock exchanges. The expectation was selling part stake in this insurance behemoth would raise enough funds to meet the equally tall divestment target of 2.1 lakh crores for the Modi government in FY21. Of that figure, a partial stake sale in LIC is expected to raise as much as 70,000 crores. Indeed, the country's largest institutional investor and the largest insurer, LIC, is the market leader in the life insurance industry, both by premium collected as well as the number of policies sold. But what's the real story behind LIC? Till the year 2000, Life Insurance Corporation enjoyed a complete monopoly. Interested buyers would reach out themselves. LIC functioned through a massive army of agents. Close to 10 lakh active agents exist for LIC by some industry estimates. The private players had a late start. But like most lean private machines, they made up for lost time with aggressive marketing and an extremely focused outreach. They had neither a customer base nor a web of agents. So they directed the bulk of their efforts through the banks they were allied with. Example, HDFC Life Insurance pushed its products through HDFC Bank, and the same for SBI Life. Ironically, with potential access to a huge universe of PSU banks, LIC did nothing. As a result, private insurance companies today hold over 80% of the top-end market that's been made accessible through bank outreach strategies. In a scenario where 50% of insurance industry contribution comes from banks, LIC neither participates nor tries to garner that market. 97% of its business comes from agencies and a measly 3% from banks. Agents themselves are a failing mechanism with very poor conversion and earnings potential. As an industry watcher pointed out, the agents are worse off than Uber and Ola drivers. With no access to the higher economic strata and a lack of novel products to pitch, this massive pool of agents is now a beast of burden for LIC. But let's stop for a bit to look at what the business looks like. Is it the business that's a losing battle, like telecom, or the player? Joining me now, Atul Mehra of Motilal, Oswal Asset Management, who looks at that space very carefully. Atul, thanks very much for joining us. Let's just set up some plot points first on what life insurance looks like as a business in India and what the potential is.
Sure. So if you look at, firstly, thanks for having me on the show. And in terms of life insurance, if you look at it, the sector as such, it is, while the headline numbers will tell you that it's penetrated at 2.8% of GDP, but the real story in life insurance lies not in the savings as a percentage of GDP. The real story lies in the share of pure protection, which is what matters in terms of coverage of life insurance. So just to quote some data from Swiss Re, if you look at it, India has a 91% protection gap. So which means that if you need a cover of 1 crore as a family to take care of your dependents, what you have instead is about 9 lakhs. So you are under-penetrated to the extent of 91% in terms of pure life cover. And that is where the biggest opportunity lies. So a lot of companies lately, in the last 5 to 7 years' time, all the private companies, if you were to look at it, HDFC Life or ICICI Prudential, even for Max Life and similarly for SBI Life, all the top 4 or 5 players, they have been spearheading this particular growth in pure protection, and there is generally more awareness that is building up for pure protection. Another key element I think I would like to highlight is the opportunity that we would have in not just mortality but morbidity, because if a particular person were to die, obviously his family has to be taken care of in terms of the financial amount. But the bigger risk in my view is that the person does not die. He maybe gets, say, a cancer or any other critical ailment, because of which he is not just able to, his earnings stop as well as his expenses rise on the medical side, and all other things remain as it is. So I think the bigger curse in terms of for any particular individual is not death. A bigger curse would be in the form of any particular life ailment that you can get. And that's where the protection opportunity, along with the opportunity in terms of covering critical illness, that is where the opportunity is even bigger. So I think a lot of people will talk about life insurance being well penetrated, but I think the real story and the real opportunity in life insurance lies in the protection and morbidity side of things.
A lot of information, of course, Atul, is not available readily or publicly about LIC, but there are public listed entities right now. And when LIC does hit the market, it will be benchmark against its listed peers. Just give us a sense of, you know, where things stand for the listed peers and what the dynamics or the 1-2-3 step process might be while valuing a company like this.
Sure. So if you look at the industry size per se, if you were to look at it, so the way we look at industry is we divide the industry in terms of new business premiums and renewal premiums. In case of India, if you look at it, India does about closer to 70,000 crores in terms of annual premium equivalent for individual new business. And in this particular new business, LIC today has a 42% market share, while the private players have about 58% market share. But given that LIC has a very large legacy book, their share of in terms of their market share in the renewal premium business is much higher. So India at 70,000 crores, that's a new business, but the overall premium, if you were to include all individual as well as group and everything in terms of renewal premiums as well, the total number stacks up to about 5 lakh crores. So in the 5 lakh crore number, LIC would have a larger market share because of the high share of renewal business. But in the new business, which we regularly track as a future forthcoming business in any business in the industry, there LIC today has a 40% market share. Having said that, I think the key numbers that we look for while evaluating an insurance company is something like embedded value that they disclose. And in case of LIC, that particular number is still not available. Obviously, when they IPO and when they file their papers, that number will be available. In terms of other metrics, some of the people will talk about things like AUM, where say an HDFC Life today has a 1,30,000 crores AUM, while LIC has a 30 lakh crores AUM. But in my understanding, it's not that simple to value a company based on AUM alone, because a lot of other things come into picture, like the quality of firstly the segment in terms of which particular product are you writing, whether it's a ULIP, whether it's a participating product, it's a non-participating product, whether it's a protection product. So a lot of those intricacies come into picture. And in case of LIC, LIC is very different from the private players, because 97% of the business approximately comes from the participating product alone. While a lot of companies on the private side, large part of business comes from ULIP, then they have a good mix of PAR and non-PAR savings as well. And for pioneers in the industry like HDFC Life, if you were to look at it, they have the highest share of pure protection, which is where the most, which is the most profitable segment as such. So in case of LIC, it is primarily participating, and they have a little bit of pure protection that they write. One other key thing with LIC, if you were to look at, is that while the private companies participating product, they have a 90-10 sharing in terms of, so the private company gets to keep 10% of the profit of the investment returns. In case of LIC, that number is only to the extent of 5%. So automatically, if you were to look at it, the revenue profile of LIC will be 50% that of private players. So if the revenue is 50%, obviously with a cost structure which is very similar to other companies, your profit margins are very, very low. So one publicly stated number that we can see, which is a factual number for that matter, is profit after tax. So if you look at it, LIC today does about 2,600 crores of profit after tax. And if you compare this with, say, HDFC Life, they do about 1,300 crores of profits. So from a pure profitability perspective, they are about 2x the size of HDFC Life. But from a something like AUM perspective, obviously they are 30 times the size of HDFC Life. But I think the market will obviously focus on profitability, because that's what valuation will all be about. And at the same time, as more of these disclosures come about in terms of embedded value, etc. So one number that we hear of as per some of the experts who have recently written on the company. So there was a Macquarie report which came out, I think, a few days back. And they have in turn spoken to some of the experts who have in the past tried to gauge embedded value of LIC. And they are talking about a number closer to 25,000 crores. which is very much near where HDFC Life is today at about 22,000-23,000 crores. So while the size looks, I would say, very gigantic in all forms, from embedded value profitability perspective, the size is very similar to that of HDFC Life.
Generally also, Atul, the Indian insurance companies actually enjoy a higher valuation than many of their global peers or even Asian peers. Is that because of this profitability factor that you alluded to? And given that, how might foreign investors view an issue like LIC? Will profitability be a big decider for them while looking at this issue?
Sure. So, firstly, in terms of if you were to look at obviously the likes of HDFC Life, they trade at closer to 5x embedded value. And the way to look at this is embedded value is the business that you've written so far and what's the future cash flow of that particular business. So that is the current embedded value. But what market is assigning to the likes of HDFC Life or any of these leading life insurance private companies is the growth value, because the market is saying that given the opportunity and given that the sector is it is so difficult for a new guy to enter the sector. Entry barriers are huge in the sector because you need brand, you need a trust, you need overall the brand equity has to be strong, trust needs to be there. You need a very strong distribution presence. Agency by itself, it's not been something which has done very well in terms of distributing life insurance. So the entry barriers are so strong that all the profitability and all the opportunity of growth will be confined to the top four or five guys who have had the brand and distribution and who've done well so far. So that's the reason that the multiples for a lot of these companies are upwards of 3 to 5x embedded value. Another key element here is that in case of developed markets, a lot of the companies there, basically, firstly, that India is a young country, so average population is about 27 years in terms of median age. A lot of developed countries, the population is quite aging. And there, the companies have written a lot of products on retirement side. And given what has happened over the last decade in terms of falling interest rates, a lot of these companies, they have been caught on the wrong side in terms of where they've contracted for rates being much higher and the realized rates today are much lower. So a lot of profitability for them has got hit because of this particular element. That is something which is not applicable to India at all, because interest rates here, while obviously they've been lower, but they've been more or less over similar range over the last 7-8 years. And in India, you don't have a retirement pool, retirement market at all. And overall guaranteed products also are about 15% for the industry. And a lot of these companies, they are actively hedging all of this exposure where they don't carry any interest rate risk. So I think to sum it up, this is a business which doesn't require a lot of capital. It is very cash generative. It is very moated because of the entry barriers that it carries. And the opportunity is large. So anybody who's looking at India and having a call on life insurance, their obvious bets are all these large private companies. In case of, I think, LIC, especially from an FIR perspective, I'm personally not too sure, because FIR, not just in LIC's case specifically, but generally, FIRs have had an aversion to investing in SOE companies. So a lot of the FIRs today, they own the likes of HDFC banks and ICICI banks of the world, whereas a lot of these PSU banks are not owned by FIRs to that extent. So I think we need to see if, given the size of LIC and the brand, etc., if there is some appetite and there is some interest from FIRs. But I think the general rule which we observe with FIRs is that they have an aversion to SOE companies. So I think let's see on that.
There were also some concerns raised post the budget, Atul, where we now have, you know, two slabs to choose from in terms of income tax, that perhaps what the finance minister was working at was disincentivizing the whole saving phenomenon or the whole saving habit. Do you think that might actually work against someone looking at insurance companies saying, hey, you know, do they have the future potential that they did earlier?
Actually, there was a lot of noise on the budget day and maybe a day after that. But if we look at the nitty-gritties in more detail, what we have observed is that anybody who is doing any kind of tax planning, investment planning, for all of these people, the old tax regime or the old tax structure is much more and continues to be as beneficial as it always was. And the new tax regime will only benefit those set of people who are never buying any of the savings products, be it a life insurance or a ELSS or a provident fund. So these are people who have never bought these products, and they might not continue to buy these products in the future as well. But for people who've always been buying these products, the old tax regime is much more beneficial for them, and the tax payout is much lower in the old tax regime. So we think that this was, there were a lot of noise that got created along the way, but this is something which is not too much of an issue at all. And having said that, I think a lot of insurance, so the key, one of the key differentiators with insurance versus other financial saving products is that here you have a complete tax exemption on the returns. So section 1010D, if you were to look at it, it makes sure that all your income from life insurance proceeds, be it savings or from death benefits, it is completely tax-free in the hands of investors. So from that perspective, investors in these products, they are better off today than they were in the past. So if you look at it, last 2 years, the government introduced long-term capital gains tax. This year, they have abolished the DDT, where the DDT is not applicable in the hands of the company. It is applicable in the hands of investors. So if you were to buy the particular, if you have an equity investment, you will have to pay a 10% long-term capital gains tax. You will have to pay dividend tax at your marginal tax rate of, say, if you're a super rich guy, you have to pay it at 43%. So in aggregate, so if you are making, say, 15% returns, on that you're paying 10%, 1.5% tax rate on the LTCG, and if the dividend yield is 1.5%, on that you're paying 43% for a super rich guy. So that adds to about another 60 basis points. So 60 basis points and 150 basis points. 200 basis points is the cost of taxation for anybody who's directly investing versus investing through a, say, a ULIP, for example. So I would think that this particular regime, the entire tax benefit of insurance is still much more superior to other financial products. And generally, another way to look at it is that a lot of banks, large proportion of fee income for banks comes from the insurance products that they cross-sell to their clients. So, and insurance being a push product and banks being incentivized to make sure that they sell the equivalent amount, the requisite amount to earn their fee income, the natural push will also be there. So I think net-net, if you were to look at it, there is nothing major that changes. And after the DDT abolishment, something like a ULIP has only got to be a more superior product than it was in the past. So I would think that it will be like people would, and that's how even the stocks, if you were to look at it, on the day of the budget, there was a panic. But post that, we've seen stocks come back as well in a big way.
Just one final question in terms of what your sense is of what the size of this issue might be, Atul, because there is talk of 10%, but then there were also concerns raised on whether the market had enough depth to absorb that larger size of an issuance from LIC. What do you reckon the size might be when it finally hits the market?
That's a tough one because we don't have any of the disclosures as yet. But as per what is now coming out, and this is numbers that I would not, these are not my numbers, these are numbers where somebody has put out as a report. So like I was mentioning earlier, Macquarie has gone out saying that as per their estimates and as per interaction with some of the experts that they have dealt with, the embedded value comes to about 25,000 crores. And if you look at it in that sense, I don't know the multiple that LIC would command. So it looks like in that case, maybe it can be 50,000 crore or 75,000 crore of market cap in that sense. And if you were to dilute 10%, 20%, it'll be 5,000 to 10,000 crores as such. So obviously these are very early estimates, and I would personally not, I cannot be saying that this will be what it is, but as per these early estimates, looks like it'll be a 50,000 crore market cap company with maybe issuance of 5,000 to 10,000 crores. So as such, I think that's where it is at. But another qualifier, like I've saying repeatedly, these are numbers which are very rough estimates. We should wait for the DRHP to get filed and look at the more details within the DRHP and take a call post that.
No, absolutely. And there's a long road before that. There's an act that needs to be ratified, and then they'll have to make that road towards the market. Atul, thank you so much for joining in today with your thoughts and insight. We really appreciate it. As history shows, LIC has always put in minimal effort coming off its history of being a monopoly and still being a government-owned company. The rising exposure of LIC to companies facing liquidity crisis has also been a cause of concern. For example, LIC is today the biggest shareholder in Yes Bank with an 8% stake. Gross bad loans for LIC jumped almost 5 times in the last 8 years through FY19 to as high as 6.15%. Analysts believe its non-performing assets or NPAs may inch up further in FY20. On the debt side, bonds of companies like DHFL, Reliance Capital, Reliance Home Finance, in which it had exposure of around 11,000 crores, have been junked by rating agencies. Its acquisition of a controlling stake in IDBI Bank in FY19 has been as much of a no-go. Elevated gross NPAs of close to 25,000 crores in FY19 actually forced LIC to set aside as much as 24,000 crores to bring down the net NPA ratio to just 0.27. Across the board, the PSU versus private battle has ended up badly for the PSU side. The finance minister is hoping to see huge investment and appetite for the LIC issue from FIIs. But recent government issues have brought home one golden truth. Foreign investors do not touch anything that looks messy. And when your core owner is not necessarily on your team, it spells trouble. Over the years, LIC has frequently been left holding the can in cases where the government has struggled to get its own poorly valued and perceived issues through. In November 2017, the 9,600 crore IPO offering of state-owned New India just about scraped through, with LIC bidding for a large chunk of the shares. Same story with state-owned General Insurance Corporation of India that saw just 1.35 times subscription. A little over half those bids came from, you guessed it, LIC. So when the time comes and LIC struggles to raise interest and subscription, who gets to be its knight in shining armor? As a sector analyst points out, it's difficult to assign a valuation because of lack of trust. When there's a lack of credibility in the leadership team, and when the motivation is just divestment, not scaling up business, why should one buy into the LIC idea? But there is legacy, and perhaps it is that the government is riding on. LIC is often seen as a sovereign guarantee of sorts. If there's trouble, the government will step in. For many ordinary citizens, PSUs and LIC spell safety. The mood in the stock market towards Delhi has also turned. Despite the market's Teflon-coated rise, there's concern about whether the government actually has any lateral thinking ability at all. In a bid to be seen as doing something about personal taxes, the finance minister announced 2 alternate slabs would be on offer. In the previous slabs, individual income taxpayers could avail a 1,50,000 deduction under Section 80C to save and invest in instruments like PPF and insurance. The idea had always been to help people imbibe the saving habit. In the new structure, there are lower tax rates, but deductions have been done away with. In effect, you're disincentivizing saving. The move could mean insurance players like LIC stand to lose any potential future income. In a year when the finance minister intends to get LIC to the market, shunning the savings habit and insurance as an idea seems like a self-goal and an exercise in bringing down possible valuations for LIC. Life Insurance Corporation has always followed a contrarian investment strategy, which is sell when the sentiment is bullish and buy when the mood is bearish, often at the cost of landing lemons. Good luck to the team that runs the LIC issue. They will need it.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.